importance of this topic of strengthening community health systems, primary health care, and the achievement, the ambition of universal health coverage. We've heard from the our representatives of the agencies and great suggestions from the elders, and we should heed those messages. I can see quite a youth in the audience. Let's make sure we actually understand that experience and bring it into our actions. But now we're going to hear from the countries, and it is a pleasure to invite, first of all, Minister Veronica Espinosa de Ecuador, for the experience of Ecuador in terms of how we may be able to learn from what you've been doing in your country to promote knowledge and knowledge uptake around the world. Minister.
Mostrar y graficar la actividad en términos de trabajadores comunitarios de nuestro país. La siguiente, por favor. Ahí, ¿me escucha? Muy bien. Entonces, la siguiente, por favor. La salud se crea allá donde la gente vive, ama, trabaja, juega. Una frase que estamos escuchando desde hace muchos años, 40 años, algunos años antes inclusive de que yo nací. Y sin embargo no ha perdido su vigencia. En el caso de mi país, esas fotos reflejan entonces en dónde está, dónde se crea la salud. En los buses, en los ríos, en los campos, en las montañas. Y sin embargo la salud seguía enfocada en los templos de la enfermedad, en hospitales lejanos a las comunidades. La siguiente, por favor. Y es así que hace poco más de una década decidimos cambiar este modelo, la siguiente. Decidimos cambiar este modelo con una inversión de más de 16 mil millones de dólares para abandonar los templos de la enfermedad y regresar a donde estaba creándose la salud, a donde estaban los individuos, a donde estaban las familias y las comunidades, con un fuerte enfoque en el primer nivel de atención y con la idea loca de llevar la salud a donde estaban las personas. La siguiente. Este modelo permitió incrementar con un modelo de gratuidad, de cobertura, de derechos, de acceso a los servicios de salud basado en el primer nivel de atención y sobre todo en la atención comunitaria, pasar de 16 millones de atenciones en mi país en el año 2006 a más de 46 millones de atenciones en el año 2017. La siguiente. Pero lo más increíble no fue solamente el número de las atenciones, sino el tipo de atenciones. En este gráfico ustedes pueden ver cómo cambiamos el porcentaje de las atenciones que se daban a nivel hospitalario en el segundo y tercer nivel en el color anaranjado en relación a las que se daban en las unidades de primer nivel de atención en el color azul, llegando en el año 2017 a tener 21% de atenciones en el segundo y tercer nivel y más del 75%, casi el 80% en el primer nivel de atención. La siguiente. Pero para hacer esto necesitábamos cambiar también el modelo de los trabajadores de la salud, dejar de tener trabajadores enfocados en un modelo medicalizado, hospitalario, de enfermedad, para tener personal de salud que pueda llegar a las comunidades. Y creamos entonces nuestros técnicos de atención primaria, una formación a nivel de tecnicatura, 2 años para los bachilleres y también el fortalecimiento de nuestros médicos especialistas, médicos familiares, no enfocados a curar enfermedad, sino a atender los determinantes de la salud, a atender aspectos como la promoción, a identificar el riesgo sanitario, a trabajar en el empoderamiento de derechos de nuestras comunidades. Esto representó una inversión de 45 millones de dólares en becas del Estado para los técnicos de atención primaria que además pertenecían a las comunidades, hablaban el idioma de la comunidad, entendían las prácticas ancestrales de la comunidad y fueron más de 2.000 técnicos de atención primaria que se formaron. A esto se suman más de 400 médicos especialistas cuyas especialidades también fueron financiadas por el Estado ecuatoriano para tener un enfoque de especialidad basado en atención primaria en salud y en la atención comunitaria. Y ahí tienen algunas fotos de nuestro equipo de atención integral con médicos familiares, técnicos de atención primaria y enfermeras comunitarias. La siguiente. La siguiente. Y muy rápidamente, ¿cuáles han sido los resultados de cambiar de una mirada curativa a una mirada con un enfoque en la comunidad, es haber llegado ya con nuestra estrategia médico del barrio, que lleva estos equipos casa por casa a buscar a los más vulnerables, a garantizar una atención continua, a trabajar en determinantes de la salud. Hoy estamos ya en más de 79, los casi 200 cantones, más de 200 cantones que tenemos en la distribución. Ustedes ven en el mapa los puntos verdes. La siguiente, con unos resultados que nos permiten concluir que la mejor forma de llegar a donde se crea la salud es ir a los espacios en donde realmente están las personas y sus necesidades. Estos son solamente unos números porque nos pidieron algo de resultados. Son más de 43.000 pacientes vulnerables identificados solamente en el último año. Son más de 133.000 casas visitadas. Pero más allá de los datos cuantitativos, el mensaje que me gustaría traer a esta discusión es que no podemos pensar en atención primaria en salud, no podemos pensar en cobertura universal, en acceso universal en salud para todos, si no diseñamos un modelo en el cual los trabajadores, quienes hacemos vivo el derecho a la salud, los trabajadores de la salud, tengamos un enfoque comunitario como lo hemos buscado en el Ecuador y creemos con mucha satisfacción que está teniendo enormes resultados. Muchas gracias.
Honourable ministers, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, as you've seen, our Director General, Dr. Tedros, has been able to join us. And excuse me if we break protocol with the ministers, invite the DG to make a few remarks. Dr. Tedros, please.
That's how we should treat the community health agents, starting from believing that primary health care is the foundation and that they are the backbone of the primary health care and can help us to mobilize and health promotion and this prevention, including ensuring community ownership because they are the foundation. So I'm really glad to see that this panel or is being actually sponsored by many countries, and the participation is really incredible. It's a full house, and that is an assurance that what I'm saying is actually what you need, otherwise you wouldn't have done. So thank you so much, and maybe see you in another.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tedros. Much appreciated that you could find the time in your very busy agenda to share some of your remarks. And of course, we all know the success that he had in his own country around strengthening primary health care and the community health system. So he's not just our boss, but he's also a very topical expert on this particular issue. So thank you very much. I'd like to move on now and address a question to Minister Bent Høie from Norway. Minister, thank you very much. I understand you've come straight off the plane into the airport here today, so thank you. Minister, you were part of the work of the High-Level Commission on Health, Employment and Economic Growth, and that sent some very strong messages about investing in the health workforce, health systems and communities. How can some of that evidence and your own experience in Norway inform some of the thinking for the rest of the world?
First of all, thank you very much to the panelists, and I can ensure my short message is that Norway strongly supports your agenda on health development policy. And to your question, it's very clear for us that it is very important to, as you also concluded, to lift up the importance of the health workers. This is my fifth health assembly, and every year I've been talking about the importance of the health workers. At the WHA 2 years ago, workers, I was, as you mentioned, I was representing the work of a high-level commission on health, employment, and economic growth. And then someone might say that I need a renewal, but my message remains the same. Health workers are the backbone of any health system. And what we showed in the commission report was how investment in education and employment of health personnel benefits society in many ways, not just in public health, but also when it comes to education in general, empowerment of women and girls, inclusive economic growth and stability. In this year, as many have mentioned, 40 years after the Armada and 70 years after WHO was created, strengthening primary health care should be our main undertaking. Our prerequisite for this investment in health workers. This workforce must be shaped by local needs, as my colleague from Ecuador pointed out. In many countries, community health workers will have an important role in building primary healthcare and public health services based on local needs. I have two messages today. First, strengthening a health system in an equitable way for universal health coverage does not first and foremost depend on the size of the government's coffers or natural resource of wealth. In fact, increasing the size of health budgets can increase inequity by improving the health of some, but not all. This is not in the line with Agenda 2030. This is an important point for me as a minister from a developed country. The foundation of the Norwegian Universal Health Coverage System was created at the time when Norway was not a wealthy country. It comes as a result of a political choice and not of increasing wealth. What truly matters is building a health system bottom up, step by step, in cooperation with the NGOs and private sector actors, and a government commitment to the critical description. Norway started more than 400 years ago with the district doctors founded by the state. They worked at the local level, providing services, and led the local board of public health. Since the beginning of the 19th century, the state also financed midwives that work all over the country. But the state was not alone. Local authorities, faith-based congregation, political organizations, and the NGOs were active partners. For example, the Norwegian Women Public Health Association established services for children that was free of charge, services that later were integrated into our health system. And second, 2030 is only 12 years from now. 12 years to achieve universal health coverage. In order to achieve this, coordination across the sector is needed. There can be no universal health coverage without education, especially for girls. And there can be no universal health coverage without fight against corruption, to make sure investments go where they are supposed to go. That is why my second message today is a reiteration of a request made by the governments of Ghana, Germany, and Norway. We have have asked Dr. Tedros to take the lead in developing a joint action plan for the achievement of the SDG 3 in order to streamline the efforts for WHO, UNAIDS, Gavi, Global Fund, the World Bank, the Global Financing Facility, and other global health actors. This will also be very helpful in making our investments in community health workers count and rely on all actors behind one coordinated efforts. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister. Much appreciated, both for that Norwegian experience, the perspectives, the women in the workforce, and the request from Norway, Germany, and Ghana. I'd like to invite now the State Minister, Dr. Kabedi Walker from Ethiopia, to also share some of his personal experiences and recollections of the role of health extension workers and the whole health extension program in Ethiopia. And again, what lessons can we learn as we look to expand to meet what both UNICEF and UNAIDS were putting as challenges to us at the opening of this. Minister.
Thank you very much. I would go directly to the health extension program. And the health extension program is our community health services. And it is our flagship program. And it's the bedrock of our health system in general. And it was introduced in early 2000 when we reviewed our health sector development program and benchmarking that cultural extension program to provide knowledge and the skill to the households, particularly to the mothers. And mothers and the children constitute about 20% of our population. And it focuses on women, so it's a woman-centered. And the services provided at community level. And there was a pilot initially, and thereafter it was scaled up. And in 5 years period, all villages in the country were covered by at least 2 health extension workers. And the health extension workers were recruited from their communities. These were high school graduates trained for a year plus in integrated service delivery model. And all health extension workers were deployed, and they are salaried and permanent civil servants. And this is an expression of commitment in practice by the government, and also to assuring the sustainability and ownership of the program. And the services are provided in integrated manner, promoting, preventive, and the curative services. And there are 4 blocks of services, mostly maternal child health, immunization, child health. We have introduced, and as we go along, we have introduced the community-based newborn care and integrated childhood management so that we save life in practice, saving lives. As neonatal days, it constitutes around 2% of our under 5 children days, and most days are also related to pneumonia, malaria, diarrhea, and also severe acute malnutrition, which is underlying cause of most of the diseases. And health extension workers are providing services at community level. So, no more nutritional treatment centers standalone. This is integrated in the services. Health extension workers are providing services both and in the community as well as in the health post, including house-to-house visits. So they as part of the community-based newborn care services, they have to visit the household where the newborn was born in the first 24 hours, the first 72 hours, and also in 7 days' time, so that she picks serious possible bacterial infections and provide treatment or they do some pre-referral antibiotic services. So it is as a result, we have achieved a lot, right? Reducing maternal and child mortalities, and we have attained million dollars in goal for child mortality reduction. And we are on track for maternal mortality by reducing around 72%, and all MDGs related to communicable disease were also attained, reducing by more than 90% new infections of HIV. And when we were introducing the health science program, the training was provided not in the health science college per se, it was provided in the technical vocational training centers, and the lack exposure to the clinical practice or health services. And as a result, we introduced integrated vocational training program with all our partners in the country. And that has also helped in transforming the health education program in sustaining the services on top of providing quality services to their level. When I say quality services, we don't expect the same level of services we expect from clinical professor. And we have introduced key life-saving interventions like ICCM, CVNC, and for community management of acute malnutrition. And also, our health extension workers are these days providing, to some extent, intrauterine devices as family planning services for those who have undergone level 4 training program. And in terms of that, these are equivalent to college diplomas. And we have linked health education program with health centers. Health centers are with under one health center we have 5 health forces. And the health centers are expected to provide technical support, supervisory support, and administrative support, including logistics to the health education workers. And the dedicated professionals are assigned to provide mentorship and the technical capacity building for these health education workers on top of targeted integrated training program, and these are helped in continuous improvement and in terms of service delivery and the quality of the services that are provided to the community, particularly women and children. And as a government, we have assured universal health coverage as we are deploying health education program that is provided for free. But we need to work on second generation of universal health coverage, addressing the financial barriers, because health education program is supported mainly for the communities on external funding, like Global Fund, Gavi, and also other donors, the bank, bilaterals. And so we need to work on for the future, so that we assure sustainability. And the community engagement, empowerment, partnership, and our ownership is assured, I can say. I can give us an example related to maternal health. Some 7-8 years ago, institutional delivery, the skilled birth attendants were not more than 20%. This is, as a disability report, is more than 80%. So addressing the first peak, addressing also the second peak, where they are working in this line. And now we are going to the second generation of indexation program, and we have launched optimization of the indexation program last week by our Deputy Prime Minister. And we will upgrade all the indexation workers to college diploma, and we will also increase their number to 5,000 population. And this will incur, of course, significant budgetary requirements. And we'll also upgrade the infrastructure. I think you see some of the photos, and we'll definitely make our health force to be health facility. Previously, we were thinking of health extension workers to provide promotional and health education services. Now they are also providing individual-based clinical or basic curative service at community level, so we expect this to be improved. And we value the partnership that we have enjoyed with global communities, multilateral, bilateral foundations, and implementing partners on the ground, without whom we couldn't have achieved what we have achieved. Though the leadership is that of the government, and the bold decisions, bold actions in practice, and this is where countries are getting difficulty in learning, because they have all the problem. If they own the problem, if they review the problem, they will come up with such bold decisions. When we talk of community health workers, we don't mean those whom we get rid of some 15 years ago, those which were project-driven, 2 weeks, 3 days, base trainings, and this could include sustainability, quality, and also program ownership in terms of the national system. So we need to minute really on as to what Her Excellency Ms. Gracia said earlier. So we have to act and we have to work even more to achieve more. As a country now, we are going to achieve transformational agendas like community transformation, total community transformation. Of course, it is not possible to bring community total transformation with health sector alone, but we need to partner with other sectors as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. And yes, you've seen the photo exhibition here that's been coordinated by our Ethiopian colleagues, and also the photo exhibition from the University of York Histories Department looking at community health workers through the ages. And also, Minister, a big thank you as well, colleagues who've been engaged in the guideline on looking at health systems and policy support for community health workers were hosted just recently by Ethiopia in their deliberations. So thank you very much for that. I'm going to move on now and invite the Permanent Secretary of the United Republic of Tanzania, Dr. Uli Sidisi, to provide some remarks on the Tanzania experience and the engagement of the Community Health Occupational Group into the formal health system. Permanent Secretary, please.
Thank you very much. It's very easy to listen to a story like emanating from Ethiopia and think that you can just copy and paste. That's challenge number one. I need to stress from the outset that there's not a single size that can fit everybody. And so in Tanzania, we had to look for a model that would be customized to meet the needs of our country. So there we involved the Minister of Health, President's Office, Regional Administration, Local Governments, Public President's Office, Public Service Management, Development Partners, Non-Government Organizations, and the like, so that we come up with an approach that will look at what can be done to address the challenges that are grown in Tanzania. But the second part of it was to identify if and how this cadre is going to make an effective contribution over and above what the current model of health delivery system does. In Tanzania, the health delivery system is organized from a dispensary that caters for the needs of at least 5,000 people. Then you go to a health center, about 50,000. Then you go to a district that goes for about 100 to above, and then a regional referral hospital. We have zonal referral hospitals, and then the national referral hospital. Now, the community, if you heard very carefully, is not mentioned anywhere. The assumption was dispensaries will be located in such a way that it will just be a walking distance to such facilities. But population growth in the country has defied that equation. So it's not unusual to have people traveling more than 20 kilometers to fetch a service that is provided by a dispensary. So we looked for a situation that will help us to address those particular needs. So we did a needs assessment. And then we realized that if people are going to be assisted where they stay, we need to standardize their training. So we developed a standard national curriculum that will address the basics that each of the community health workers need to have. Then we drew a job description, and then we provided them with standard operating procedures, also incorporated the continuous professional development, so that once they've completed their 12-month training, these people's knowledge will be relevant to the day as it changes and as we find evidence to change our practice. Number two was to find where these people are living, draw them from the population so that once they've been trained, they will go back and help their people, address the cultural norms, the taboos, and everything, teaching our people to unlearn habits that would not be pro-health, and then streamline this cadre into the civil service. Now, those of you who've been following news about our country, we've had issues with the wage bill, but also we had to do data cleaning for the civil service, where over 3,000 post workers were identified and had to be taken out. And then we had this massive backlog of former trained human resource for health that had not been absorbed by the normal mechanism that the civil service will do in the course of time, replacing those that are not so old, but those that would pave room for others in the society. So adding in another cadre was a serious hurdle that had to be overcome. So much as they are needed in our societies to inform our people on best practices in living that will encourage health and also promote health-seeking behavior, we had a challenge to encourage the public service management to recognize and streamline this particular cadre. The understanding is very clear, the need is very right, but the resources behind agreed about 8,900 community health workers in our country to our curriculum. We are trying to encourage local governments at the village level to see if they can engage them, because that's where they're coming from, provide them with some stipend, and help address healthy issues. There are specific illustrations in our country where this has been done. One particular village known as Uturo in Marali district has not had maternal death for the past 18 years, which was part and parcel of their life, and they never used to make party for fear that this is going to contaminate other societies. Now, the most important and crucial part is this is a solution by the community to community problems. It is not a prescription that somebody comes, looks, and says, this will be good for you. So ownership is there. And also, this is contributing to a health lifestyle, because they would address issues that are found in their community that would negate all the efforts that the nation has at encouraging better health for our society. We have programs that are running in the country addressing major diseases such as malaria, tuberculosis, HIV/AIDS, and the ravages of nutrition. This has just been an added advantage that can provide now for some funding to facilitate the deployment of this essential cadre in our society. I want to assure this audience and myself, coming 3 years down the line, our story, I'm not saying will be the same, but Ethiopia, be prepared for a surprise.
I'll leave the two of you to have that discussion, that challenge that's just been put on the table. But that's the type of ambition exactly that we do need. Colleagues, part of my job is trying to keep us all to time, but we've got such rich experience from the panelists, the countries. But I would like to invite a number of speakers and partners in this country efforts and in the work with WHO, UNICEF, and UNAIDS. Firstly, if I can please give the floor to Alma Golden, the Deputy Assistant Administrator for Global Health at USAID, who's collaborating with UNICEF, WHO, and others. Alma, please.
Microphone, please.
For the translation.
United States Agency for International Development actually started providing community health workers about 40 to 50 years ago. And so over the last 45 years or so, we've had the privilege of working with many of the countries that are represented here today. And we've found some wonderful models that are being developed even further. And we're so pleased to see that. We believe that community health workers have
We've also got ministers and other country representatives in the audience, and I'd like to invite Minister Dr. Bernard Hafiku from Namibia just to give us a short comment on your experience. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much for the opportunity, and thanks for the input by very distinguished panel. Just a little bit from the Namibian experience, which is actually derived from the Ethiopian experience, unlike Tanzania there. We went to Ethiopia in 2013 to look at their health extension program. After we have reviewed our health system in 2008, and we realized that by 2008, all the services were basically delivered at the health facility. There was no community activity. And this was the beginning of the training of our own community health workers based on the Ethiopian model. So we embarked on that, and we called them directly community health workers. We trained about 2,000 or just over 2,000 community health workers for Namibia. But then, Namibia is a population of 2.3 million people, so don't get me wrong. And out of that, more than 2,000, we managed to deploy at least 1,600. And we have about 600 still not deployed. And that speaks to the issue of resources. I fully agree with my colleague from Norway that it's not money that solved the problem. But truly speaking, there has been a budget cut. There has been a cut from Global Fund. But there has also been inefficiencies and perhaps fraudulent way of deploying money. And I want to put it on record that last year I was on TV asking the president to ask whether I must be the one to save him or the permanent secretary. So one of us is out and one of us is in, precisely because of inefficient and fraudulent deployment of resources. We counted more than 200 million that were put through that system. I have to put it on record. So it's not like we asking for help all the time. We're also fighting it, but it's not easy politically. When I and my accounting officer have to be separated. So I just want to put that on record. We somehow successfully deployed those community health workers, and they are doing integrated services from environmental health. By the way, Namibia, I think, is one of the few countries with a law on environmental health in Africa. So we do environmental health, we do integrated infectious and non-infectious disease, maternal health, immunization, health education, trying to target mostly the vulnerable, like the disabled, the children, the mother, and the elderly. The program, as I say, is running very well, but the challenge we're having, apart from what I've said, the cutting in funding, also, I think, logistic-wise, like transport, we're battling a bit to get, because our country is here. Our country is a vast country. We're struggling a bit with transport and support for communication media like smartphone, tablet, and also a regular updating of this community health as the new need arise. So this is where we are battling, but we think we are moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister, making the connections between education, employment, budget, and good governance. So much appreciated. Whilst to the Minister's right, Stefan Pettersson from UNICEF, we heard the inspirational words from Executive Director Henrietta Fore, but please, Stefan, on behalf of UNICEF in the room.
Thank you very much. One of my mentors is Professor Francis Omaswa, former Director General of the Ministry of Health in Uganda. He famously said, health is made at home, hospitals are for repairs. And I think what we're talking about today is that in between and how we support the home in actually producing health. And we agree that community health, as we heard our executive director say, must be the front end of primary health care as we strive towards universal health coverage, which is also Dr. Tedros' song here. We believe that that community health is actually where you can act on the multi-sectoral determinants of health, as we just heard from Namibia, so it's much more than healthcare. It's a multi-sectoral approach. But it's also crucially where you can foster accountability in terms of systems and how they deliver and not. I want to make it very clear that from a UNICEF perspective, we see that the volunteer notion of a community health worker in a torn T-shirt is not what we're talking about. It takes a system. The community health worker cannot be alone. It takes a supportive community health system, which is what we are emphasizing. We also heard in the example our executive director brought that it might not be the traditional community health worker. Maybe in some contexts and some countries it is a private sector worker who is that frontline health worker as an extended arm of the system. UNICEF, in collaboration with our partners, many of whom are in this room here, we are ready to work with governments actually to make this happen. Certainly to make the frontline health workers learn and actually construct point of care learning. But that's only the start. You need to institutionalize the policies that underlie this community health system. You need innovative digital health solutions that we can help you discuss. And I know that the minister from Namibia is a champion for a lot of that experimentation. We need last mile supply chain systems. Because if you are there to treat pneumonia and you don't have amoxicillin, you're not going to treat pneumonia. It's that easy. You also need information and data systems, not just to feed information back to the health management information system, but also to feed the accountability system that I referred to before. So, as my executive director and everyone else has said here, today, UHC needs to happen through PHC, which requires a community health system as its front end. And UNICEF stands ready to work with you all, along with its partner, but I would particularly like to point out someone who's still struggling with the WHO registration system. She should have been here to say this. She's Dr. Angela Gichaga of the Financing Alliance, which is an entity that many of us have supported in setting up. Angela Gichaga and the financingalliance.org is a one-stop shop for you to call and actually get assistance in setting this up in addition to department offices. So thank you very much. Onwards to UXC.
Thank you very much, Stefan. I've got two more interventions, then I'm going to come back to the panel of ministers and honourable Professor Michelle, just for one takeaway message from all the country experience that you've heard. So just to give you a bit of warning there. And just to recognise that Dr. Tedros and Henrietta Fore have reached agreement on a stronger partnership between the two UN agencies on driving primary healthcare community health systems. And so you'll see a lot more of Stefan and I helping and supporting countries in the future, helping Tanzania get ahead of Ethiopia. Lay your bets on that one, ladies and gentlemen. Dr. Gathinji Gitahi, Chief Executive Officer from AMREF, known for its long history in Africa on training health workers. And then I will go to the delegate from Iraq.
Thank you very, very much. And I think the first thing I would like to say is that when I attend meetings like this, they always sound like I'm in charge. Where, despite the disagreement on who is preaching, the message is never doubted. There's never been a dissent about are they needed, are they not needed, and and I go back to what Mama Michelle was saying, that you talk about this but you don't do anything. So for me now, it sounds like it's no longer a technical issue. It's not a financial issue either. Technically, we know as an organization that works with community health workers, that when you enable a community health worker with a mobile phone that's enabled, they become agents for recruiting people to national health insurance, they become agents for collecting data from households, they become agents for referral, they become agents for supporting the community. They actually become the seventh building block of the health system when you add them to the other six, because they are the ones who actually link the demand side. So there's no debate about technical. Financially, when I look at a country like Kenya, where I come from, it requires only 3-4% of the entire health budget to actually integrate, pay them, train them, and integrate them into the health system. 3%. In fact, Kenya did spend about $380 million investing in secondary and tertiary care on equipment. That's like 10 years of 25,000 community health workers integrated into the health system. So it's actually not a question of technicality, financial, it's a political issue. And I don't think there's anyone of us here who has ever been a wife to a president except Professor Michelle. So I'd like to ask her a question. She has that privilege. Considering that community health workers are such a central issue to our health system, and specifically in informal, low-income settings, so critical, how come this issue never reaches the table of the president? Because when I see my colleagues here from Tanzania elsewhere struggling to explain what's going on, the issue is that the ministers of health are convinced. I see them struggling. We then tell them, please go and talk to your minister of finance. They go there and they struggle because everyone is convinced. But nobody is going to make a decision to employ 25,000 new cadre in a country without a presidential declaration. It is on the president's table, Grassman Chair. It is on that table. And I would like you to probably tell me, who is stopping it from getting to that table? Who is against us? That we've been talking about this issue, but nothing actually gets where it should be. For me, it's no longer technical. Evidence is enough. It is the presidents who have to make the declarations for us to integrate and employ them to the health system. Thank you very much.
From Iran, and then we're going to come back to the ministerial panel.
Thank you very much. I'd like to share our experience. 35 years ago, we for rural areas, and at that time 70% of population were living in rural areas, and we trained about 30,000 neighbors, which are transported in 18,000 health houses. But the situation has changed. Now 70% of people are living in urban areas, and in the health transformation plan we started to employ more than 22,000 midwife and nurses from private sector. Half of them are from private sector, and they have started to deliver system to people who are living in the cities. One on the last point is that the payment system should be performance-based payment. We found that during past 35 years, if we don't put the correct payment system for them, we will find a difficulty at it. Thank you.
So, colleagues, sorry we can't get more questions and more comments. We really are coming up to the hour, and we need to give the panelists a chance. One of the reasons why my Japanese ADG engaged me was because obviously Japan is very polite and may not push ministers and others to speak in a short time, but I can. My Irish heritage means you can talk as you need to. So, panelists, in 30 seconds or less, your takeaway messages, and I'm going to go from left, my left to right. Tim Martin, UNAIDS, please. Oh, Sunil, comments? I was going to come back to you. Spoke first. We're going to ask you to speak last. Tim.
I'm not sure if you're speaking first or last. Okay, just 3-4 points. I loved the point around the fact that we need to use community health workers for prevention and promotion, and not just the curative services. We quote from the people from Uganda was very, very strong. I think that the key point is this is not a poor service for poor people, and I think one of the reasons that it has systematically failed sometimes in the past is that there are not the resources and not the systems put in place to support that. And I love the point about time to act and political leadership to drive it forward.
Minister Bentoy.
Thank you very much. First of all, I think this discussion will give us hope, but I think the thank you to our message is that there has to be local ownership, but it has to be set in a national system, and there is international experience to learn from each other to have success. And I will again say there will not be universal health coverage without fighting against corruption and fighting for education. Thank you.
Minister Espinosa, headsets on, people.
Creo que se ha dicho bastante y queda muy poco que decir en relación al rol que juegan los trabajadores de la salud en el ámbito comunitario luego de las muchísimas experiencias. Sin embargo, creo que hay un elemento adicional que no ha sido tocado y que es fundamental, y es el rol que juegan los trabajadores comunitarios en un sistema de salud para generar participación social. Los trabajadores, además de garantizar servicios, además de garantizar promoción y prevención, empoderan a las poblaciones, tienen la capacidad de empoderar mujeres, de empoderar comunidades alejadas, distantes por temas de idioma, por temas de segregación, los presidentes, a los políticos involucrados en estrategias que garanticen atención primaria en salud a través de trabajadores comunitarios, necesitamos votantes que crean en el trabajo comunitario, que crean en la atención primaria en salud, y eso también se puede lograr cuando tenemos promotores y trabajadores de la salud que crean empoderamiento y participación social.
Thank you. I must say I liked what I have heard, and I would like to say, let's transform this really in a global movement. We have very good examples of it can be done, it's being done, but it has to become global. Every single country making the commitment to make it happen. I just want to remind all of us that who signed actually to the SDGs, it is our heads of state or heads of government. So I like the idea which came from AMREF, that it has to be at the presidents, it has to be prime ministers, so that they give the driving command for all the cabinet which has to participate in this to provide resources and to make it happen. Secondly, I wanted also to say, I like what I heard from Namibia. We do have, sometimes, it's not a problem of resources. It's how the resources are being used. And so it is important that, yes, we have the political leadership. Yes, we have the resources which are required. Yes, we need to use as best as possible the resources which are allocated to this program so that it reaches really those who need it best. And finally, I just wanted to say, you know, really, really, let's make this of a commitment in which we cannot come again in 2030 and say, we promise, we failed. It is not allowed.
Thank you. My take home message would be to assure political commitment and ownership and allocation of resources, adequate resources, to integrate the health, primary health care system, particularly the community health services, and not to run parallel system, and to have a continuous learning and improving system. This is my message. Thank you.
I subscribe to the dictum that a 1,000-mile journey begins with one step. Community health worker CADA is not another CADA. It's a continuum of the care that the healthcare industry has to provide. Yesterday, we walked the talk. Take-home message is each one of us, irrespective of whichever country they're coming from, must walk the talk.
Sunil, can I ask you just your quick reflections, given as a health worker in the community, you've heard these action messages, just your quick thoughts.
Actually, we are restricted in a single place of working. So in this forum, I learned the experience of different countries. So that, after getting back to our place, we can implement these practices in our area.
Finally, back to my boss, Dr. Naoko, for a few closing remarks.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much, all of you, and for discussion, and very rich discussion. Thank you very much. I'd like to say really quickly, very three issues. First of all, the community health worker is a front line of the quality of care and also the monitoring equity of the care. So this is, I would like to say that. The second issue is, as WHO, with the other UN partners, and other partners, civil society, and also the, under the ownership of the government, we would like to work together to make the integrated, sustainable one health system in all countries, rather than a fragmented system of future. And finally, we really need to ask the senior person, elderly person, still you need to work together with us and share with your energy and also your experience and wisdom. Especially the, we're facing the demographic change, so really would like to continue to work with you and deal with this. So thank you very much. For